Hello world, welcome to this new video. Today, we are going to talk about the software updates I made on the system since the previous video. Let's jump right into it. In the previous video, I talked about I2C. I explained how it works and why I chose it. I opted for a software implementation of it. In other words, I didn't add any dedicated chip for it. I'm using GPIOs for simulating it. I've written a driver for this with a simple API, and I also added comments to it, which makes the use of this API, of course, and so we are able to interact with I2C devices directly from the command line. So the two commands are I2C set for writing on the I2C bus, and the other one is I2C get for reading from the I2C bus. Let's try connecting the I2C EEPROM I showed in the previous video. This one. So as you can see on the breadboard, I've connected the I2C EEPROM and I have another chip to generate the open drain output. I've plugged this to the system port here. The FPGA is here on the right. Let's check the software. Let's have a try reading its first 16 bytes. I use I2C get commands. So the address is 50 in hex. Usually you find this information in the component datasheet. Then we can specify a register. In our case, we will pass 0, which means we want to read the content starting at offset 0 of the EEPROM. Then the destination address, which is the memory location where we will store the bytes received. In that case, we are going to use the RAM bank because it's entirely available to the user. So let's use 8,000 in hex and 16 for the number of bytes to read. As you can see, we've received the first 16 bytes of the EEPROM, I2C EEPROM. Similarly, we can also write data to it with the command I2C set. Let's write few bytes at the offset 100 in hex. I2C set, device address 50 still. We can pass some bytes directly with minus B. First the offset, 100, then 42, 43, 45, and 46. Okay, 5 bytes. Let's read back this data. I2C get, offset 100. Let's put this in 8,000 and 5 bytes. We can read back the data. Great. So that's it for the I2C. Now we are going to talk about another protocol that I mentioned in the previous video and which will be very useful for us today, which is UART. Its main purpose is to let two computers communicate with each other for data transfer, of course. Once again, I opted for a software implementation. In fact, usually UART is very important on homebrew computers as it represents the primary way of communication with the board. Here, the board is a standalone thanks to the keyboard and the FPGA, which outputs a VGA signal. So apart from sending and receiving data synchronously, there is not a big need for a UART chip. Like for the I2C, I've implemented a UART driver, which is used with two commands, which are UART send, SND, and UART receive. We can try sending a message from my Linux computer to the board. To do so, I will be using this USB to UART adapter on the computer. To connect it, it's very easy. We connect the board RX to the adapter TX, which is the orange cable here. And same goes for the TX of the board, which we connect to the RX of the adapter. And of course, we should not forget to plug the ground. We are first going to make the board wait on the UART. So we will use the UART receive command. So the baud rate will be 57,600. And destination address, we're going to put it in 8,000 in hex. And let's wait for 6 characters. Yep. Okay. Now let's check the computer. I've plugged the converter to my computer and a new node has been added to dev. So let's check it. Okay, the new node is called dev.tty.usb0. We can use any serial monitor such as Minicom or Picocom, but in my case, I will use the Linux terminal directly. First thing we have to do is configure the UART interface as raw to avoid having the Linux driver processing data that we are going to send. And we also need to specify the baud rate. So we will use stty command. We specify the node. And we say it's a raw format and 57,600 as a baud rate. Okay, now it's configured. So the board is already waiting for the message. Let's send 6 bytes minimum. The rest will be just discarded. So let's echo hello. And let's send this to dev.tty.usb0. So we've received something on the board, but it's not shown. We can read the memory. 6 bytes. And we can see that we received the message from the computer. Great. So what does it mean? It means that not only we can send text between two computers, but we can also send programs to execute. This is what we are going to try now. As I said in the previous video, Zeal is powered by a Z80 CPU. There are plenty of tools available online for it, such as compilers, assemblers, disassemblers, emulators, and so on. In my case, I decided to choose Z80ADK. In fact, it's a complete tool thing for Z80-based computers. It has multiple compilers, assembler, disassembler, emulator, well, everything that we need. I've used its assembler called Z80ASM to write the whole system, and this is what we are going to use today to write a hello world. As for the IDE, any text editor will be okay, Emacs, Vi, Notepad++. In my case, I find Visual Studio very convenient. Indeed, it has some very interesting Z80 extensions. I'm using Z80 Macro Assembler for syntax highlighting colors. I'm also using Z80 Assembly Meter, which gives the amount of bytes and clock cycles the code we are writing takes, and Z80 Instruction Set. It gives a write panel with a list of all the instructions, very convenient when starting learning Z80 assembly. And also, it gives more info about an instruction when the mouse is hovering it. Before digging directly into the code, a very quick reminder on Z80 architecture. Z80 CPU presents 6 general purpose 8-bit registers named B, C, D, E, H, and L. And also 8-bit accumulator, A register, and a flag called F. There is also an alternate set of registers, which uses the same names followed by prime. So A prime, F prime, B prime, C prime, D prime, well, you see. This alternative set of registers was mainly intended to be used to speed up interrupt handler routines. The registers can be accessed in pairs in order to form 16-bit registers. So we have AF, BC, DE, and HL. There are also special purpose registers, which are I, used to specify the interrupt vector location, R for dynamic refresh signal, IX and IY used as pointers followed by an 8-bit offset, SP for the stack pointer, and PC for the program counter. All these details can be found in the official Z80 user manual. I will put a link in the description. We have 8 general purpose registers. Their role is implicit and defined by the instructions the Z80 has. For example, A register is the accumulator. It is the only register that can store the result of arithmetic operations such as add, subtract, OR, AND, XOR, compare, etc. B and BC are generally used as counters for loops. HL is used as a pointer to memory and also as the 16-bit accumulator. So it stores the result of 16-bit arithmetic operations, add and subtract. DE is also used as a memory pointer. In correlation with HL, DE is the destination pointer and HL is the source pointer. Let's start by opening a file called hello.asm. We start by including the header file that I've imported, which has all the functions with public functions which are in Rome already. Include. Then we specify the origin of the program, so from which memory address it will start running, 8000 in our case. Then let's define the label for the message to print, DM for defining a message, or a sequence of bytes, hello world. We add a null byte to the end of the string. Then we load the message address into HL. Then we simply need to call print string, which is a function provided inside the ROM, and return. Now we can try compiling this or assembling this. Let's show the help. We can see all the options available to us. So we are going to use catasm minus mz80 because we would like to link it to the z80 CPU. Output binary hello.bin. We specify the ASM file, and we have to add minus b to say that we want to assemble and link relocate to file of bin. All right, so we do have our hello.bin now. We can try disassembling it. And we can see that there is the code that we just wrote, and these are the data of the message. So they are interpreted as instructions, but they are not instructions, of course. We can try sending this message to the board. So back on the board, we are going to receive data from the computer, which is the new program, of course. So we specify the baud rate, the address, which is the same as the origin one that we've put at the top of the program, and the size of the program, 21. We have 21 bytes. 21. Now we can send it, and it's received. We can try executing the code, which is at address 8000, which is the program we just received, and it works. So we can transfer programs from the computer to the board thanks to the UART. Great. We can also read the program that we've just received, is readmem. We specify the memory address and 21 bytes. And we can see that these are exactly the same bytes that we saw with the disassembler. So we received it correctly. Okay, it's nice. We've printed the message thanks to print string, and our code is very small, but maybe we can do something more interesting. Let's have a try. So we can do colors on the text mode. As you can see, there are 16 colors. So 0 is black, 1 is dark blue, 2 is dark green, etc., etc. And so we have background colors and foreground colors for any character on the screen. So how does that work? In a single byte, we will combine both colors of a character. So the high nibble is the background color and the lowest nibble is the foreground color. Okay, let's print all the colors on the first line of our screen. First of all, let's print 16 spaces on the first line. We will use this as blocks, because if we only draw the background color, there will be only colors, no text. So we load in these 16 space character in register A. We create a loop where we load A in HL. So we have to load HL with 0, because 0 is the address of the first character of the video RAM, which is the top left character. So we write the space character into HL, we increment HL to go to the next character, and we can use DGNZ loop. So what does this instruction do? So as you can see, it will decrement b, and if b is not equal to 0, we will jump to our label, to loop in our case. Okay, after we've done that, so we've only cleaned the first line, we don't need this anymore. we will start adding the colors. So now HL show B IO video colors address. So this is the address of the first character's color. We will load A with the black background color, so 0. Then again, we load B with 16, we create another loop, and inside we will load H with A, again, increment HL, but this time we need to add to A 10 in hex, so it will increment by 1 the background color. And finally, btn set loop 2. Okay. So now we can have a try. We can use cat, yep, the same command as previously. Oh, okay. We need to include the header file containing the video macros. Anything related to video. Okay, cool. So the size of the file now is 25, and we can transfer it directly to the board. Okay, let's check the board now. On the board, we will start receiving bytes from the UART. Once again, we specify the baud rate and the address. The size is 25. We'll launch the transfer. Okay, it has been transferred, and we can now execute the code. And voila, we can see the colors now on screen. That's a more interesting example. I hope that you enjoyed this video. It was more a proof of concept of the UART and the I2C, more than a tutorial on how to develop for the AT CPUs or how to develop for this board particularly. So I think this is the last video of these two boards. As you saw last time in the previous video, this board is already finished, which is the FPGA board. And I also received this one, which is the main board. So I've soldered every component on it. It seems to be working properly, and now we can even connect the two boards together to have a standalone computer, which is much more convenient than these two boards. So this is it for this video. Thank you for watching, and see you next time.